the beginning basics modules, R2T4, you're in the right place. One thing I want you to note, first of all, I'm June Perry from TG, and first thing I want you to note, in your booklets on page 37, there is an evaluation form that I want you to automatically tear out right now, because we do want to receive those before you leave today. Be sure to silence your pagers and your cell phones. This session is being recorded, so definitely do not want Brooks and Dunn to interrupt the session. Restrooms are located right outside this room, to the left, all the way to the very end, past the registration desk. So if you need to exit out at that point. If you have any additional questions after today's session and it's getting more detailed on R2T4, you can definitely join David Garza in the group cafe session in Rinkie this afternoon. So with that, I would definitely like to introduce David Garza, our presenter today. He is a senior policy advisor and legislative liaison. David serves as TG by analyzing laws and regulation for TG and its business partners, and by developing and presenting on federal student aid topics to schools and conferences nationwide. He's committed to articulating policy in a meaningful way that helps audience recognize the importance of financial aid rules and regulations, and he does a very good job at doing that. David's worked in the financial aid industry for more than 17 years. His experiences include Title IV administration with UT Austin, policy and regulatory affairs with TG, and account management for national and private lender. So with that, I'm going to let him take
thanks, June. How's everyone this morning? Good. See some familiar faces from the basic sessions that we provided earlier. You're on the Return to Title IV French track, like the tour of Italy at Olive Garden, right? For those of you that were not there, we missed you. Okay. We covered a lot of good information this morning, myself and my colleague, Michelle Anderson. We'll definitely be at the Discussions Cafe this afternoon for your fun and entertaining questions related to this topic. So today's session is going to build upon the basics. So we've entitled this one Beyond the Basics. What we started to find was that the session, first of all, when you think about the Return to Title IV funds topic, is that we're starting to run more than 80 slides, as you can appreciate. So we decided to break this one up and make it a little more digestible, if you will, as digestible as it can be, I suppose. And so we're going to build upon this discussion we had this morning. In addition, we'll have some helpers. We are taping this so that way your colleagues can see you on YouTube and places elsewhere, right? But we'll want to clearly get your question. That'll be important to us, so that way when your question's provided, I can respond to that as well. So this is definitely a complicated area. So what we're going to do is we're going to talk about some concepts. We're going to lay some fundamentals. I think these fundamentals are important, but more importantly, they are going to help us better understand the requirements. Okay, so well, my hope is that when you walk away from the session, you will have a better understanding of the requirements related to programs offered in modules, how to handle those. We'll talk about some special situations as well that that you may find on your campus where you need guidance. And they're not situations you're going to see every day, but I can assure you when you do see them, you're going to want to run to the handbook to assist you with these situations. So let's go ahead and take a look at our agenda. First, we're going to review some general principles about Return to Title IV. We'll then look and further and explore the Return to Title IV funds requirements related to programs offered in modules. Let me take a show of hands here. How many of you have modular programs on your campus? Okay. For those of you that don't, you may find out that you have them, okay, at the end of this session. In addition, let me ask this. How many of you take attendance at your school, or are required to by an outside entity or accrediting body? A couple. For those of you that didn't raise your hand, I'll assume you're not required. I'll ask one more probing question. How many of you have credit hour programs on your campus? Okay, a good number. Those of you that did not answer, how many of you have clock hours? How many of you have both? Okay, quite possible, right? So that way it gives us, you can, based on the raise of hands, you can obviously get a sense of who's in our room and what's going on, again, with the complexity of the requirements. We'll also, again, we'll talk about some special situations. One's related to death of a student within a period. That one sometimes comes up. It obviously has to be handled with utmost care, but there are certainly requirements. We'll speak to inadvertent overpayments. If you've not seen these, you may become more familiar with these by the end of the session. We'll also talk about verification, some issues related to verification and timing related to special situations. And then finally, everyone's favorite, we'll certainly talk about audit and program review findings, and more importantly, what are the errors behind them, and what can we do to try to prevent them or try to eliminate them. And then finally, also, we'll explore some resources. You've got to have some resources from the Department of Education. So in general, we're going to, just to sort of set a stage again, we need to talk about some general principles. These are principles that are going to guide us with the return of Title IV funds concept. They're certainly simple principles, but this is not a simple topic, okay? So there's a duality here. First, you know, we all understand that students are entitled to receive Title IV funds that they earn up to their withdrawal date. So for time that they spend in school, they are going to earn a percentage of their aid as they work through and to try to complete the period. Now, if they earn less funds than they receive, obviously funds have to be returned to the programs. Depending upon your charges as an institution, if they're much higher, there's certainly going to be cases where the student and the school, or possibly both, will actually have to return funds. Now, in instances where they actually earn more aid than what has been delivered, okay, and that's possible depending upon when they apply and what their timing is, then at that point they may be due funds, which would come in the form of a post-withdrawal disbursement. But as you can see, this is just simply an earned aid concept that sets up the stage for these students. So now what we're going to do is we need to better understand when return of Title IV funds actually applies. You know, again, for those of you that have different types of programs, you're going to want to tune in here. But specifically, when we talk about credit hour programs, okay, if the student does not complete all the days of the period that they were scheduled to complete, return of Title IV funds is going to apply. Now, these rules were adjusted. They were adjusted to account for students who were taking modular coursework, because there was sort of a disparity between those that were taking modular coursework as opposed to those that were taking coursework that spanned the entire period. So to account for the inequitability there, what the department did was they actually adjusted these rules to account for, again, all the days. This will become important as we start to talk through what it means for someone to withdraw from a modular program. Now we're going to talk about clock hour, okay, because there's a different standard here. For clock hour programs, if the student doesn't complete all the clock hours and weeks of instruction that they were scheduled to complete, they would then also be considered withdrawn. I'll throw some oddities out a little bit later, but just for the purpose of this, this is when return of Title IV funds would apply. Now, you could possibly also have a non-term or non-standard term program. These are both clock hour or credit hour, for that matter. So if you have these situations, simply remember that if the student's not scheduled to begin another course within the 45-day period after the module that they just took ended, they could also be considered withdrawn. Okay, the spirit here is to see that they re-enroll again within the 45-day window. And if they don't, again, return of Title IV funds would apply in that situation. So these again, are some general principles that we have to fundamentally understand before we can start talking about modular programs. So now what we need to do is remember, when does it not apply? That may be a little bit easier in some instances, or it may not be, okay, depending upon the new requirements here. So remember that if they provide confirmation at the time of withdrawal that they plan to return within that same period, they are not considered withdrawn. You know, but remember here, this becomes a little bit tricky, because as a school, you have to first of all confirm, and you really need to have a tracking mechanism to make sure they actually follow through, for that matter. Okay, because if they don't come back, return of Title IV funds, again, it does apply. Now, also, some things to keep in mind with this confirmation. Again, you have to have some layers on this to make it a little bit fun, right? If when you think about at time of withdrawal, okay? It doesn't mean literally at that time. It could be a little bit later, and it could actually go up to the 45-day mark when you would be required to return funds. So you have some flexibility here. Another complexity, students can actually change this written confirmation, okay, as long as it's prior to the start of that period. So they could actually change their date. That may need to be something that you incorporate within this process. And, you know, keep in mind that if you're talking about an approved leave of absence too, they couldn't change the date to extend it beyond the 180-day requirement when it comes to a leave of absence. But again, they do have that flexibility to change it. And then finally, for a non-term or non-standard term program, remember that the spirit here is that they come back within 45 days from the end of the last module that they were attending. That's sort of the spirit of these rules. And if, again, they don't return, calculations are required. So now let's look at that student's confirmation of attendance. Now, I've talked about the confirmation. It has to be in a written form, but again, it can be online. When you think about this confirmation, what you're trying to get at is you're trying to get at, again, the student's intent to come back, especially when we're talking about modular programs. Okay, get at their intent to come back. And again, they have to resume attendance, because if they don't resume, return of Title IV funds would apply. Now, we should look at an example. I think that would help us here. Let's say we have a term, and the term is comprised of three modules. Okay, our student is enrolled in Module 1, and they're enrolled in Module 3. Okay, student starts Module 1, and they stop out. They don't change enrollment for Module 3, they just stop out of 1. In that instance, you cannot assume that because they are enrolled in Module 3 that they are coming back. You would need confirmation in that example to make sure that they do plan to come back and that they express their intent in that respect. Another option, though, we could alter this example. Let's say the student, at the time that they stop out of that first module, they add courses for the second module while still keeping the third module intact. In that instance, because of their action to add a course, that would be considered a confirmation, a positive confirmation. So in that instance, while you're not gathering something written, the department does allow for that example or that instance to, again, use enrollment in that situation. Okay. We need to look also at some other instances when return of Title IV funds does not apply. Now there are cases where for term-based programs, we know that a student may withdraw, and they may not even provide confirmation, right? But if they do return unknowingly amongst you find out they come back and they actually finish, in that instance, you would have to undo the return of Title IV funds calculation. Now, it's possible for a clock hour program or a non-term credit hour program that student could withdraw, a calculation might be completed, and the student would return within 180 days from the point that they left. That's another situation where you would have to undo that calculation that has been completed. So again, the takeaway for this slide, keep in mind that if you've done something, you may have to undo it. That's the key there. So now what we need to do is we need to examine some questions, some important questions that you need answers for. And you're probably thinking, okay, well, what is a module? You need to make sure everyone's on the same page for that one. And, you know, when is a program offered in modules? So we're going to consider these questions as a framework for the next few slides and on our examples. So the term module, it's simply going to refer to a course or even a set of courses that don't span your entire length of the period. Now, we could be talking about, we're talking generally about terms, semesters, quarters, trimesters, or even a non-term program. Now, I've heard schools refer to this as a number of different ways. Some of you may think about this as mini terms, mini sessions. You know, I've even heard mini modules. Just remember, categorically, the department's now referring to these as simply modules. So, now, if a program is offered in modules, if that course or courses, they don't span the entire length of the period. So when you're determining whether a program's offered in modules, you're going to have to look at this on a period-by-period basis. So whether that's the payment period or period of enrollment, you're going to have to consider what that student's enrollment is. Now, another thing to keep in mind, too, is that you could possibly have some courses that actually span the entire length of the period that the student may be enrolled for, and you could even have some that don't. So their enrollment is a combination of courses that are modular and courses that are traditional as we know them. Now, in that instance, that student would be in a modular program for that period. But the point to remember here is that you have to look at these on a period-by-period basis, because it will really just depend upon what the student decides to do. And so now, let's go ahead and take a look at some examples. I think this will be helpful. So let's say we have XYZ College, okay? XYZ College, they offer a credit hour program in semesters with two optional summer sessions. Now, all the courses in the fall and spring span the entire length of the period. Summer sessions, they're 7 weeks long and they're offered sequentially. And the school actually combines the summer sessions to comprise one term. Now, a student, they may enroll in either session, depends upon what their needs are, and all courses for each session are 7 weeks. So the fundamental question here is, okay, you know, when is this program offered in modules? Well, it's not offered in modules for the fall and spring term. That's pretty straightforward, because we know that courses in fall and spring span the entire period. However, your summer becomes tricky here, because again, it is offered in modules for the purposes of our discussion today. And because one, it's not only two sessions, but none of those courses, they do not span the entire length of the period. So this again, depending upon your school, you'll need to look at this and whether or not this applies to you. Now let's go ahead and take a look at another example. Let's say in our summer situation, the school now offers summer session courses that are 14 weeks in length, and the student only enrolls in these courses that are 14 weeks in length. So for purposes of our situation, is this modular? No, it's not. But there's a variation we could add here. What if that student had a combination of courses that span the entire period but did not? That's an instance where this student would be in modular coursework. So again, cannot stress this enough, period by period determination to determine whether or not you have a student that is in a program offered in modules. So there's three fundamental questions that everyone should be familiar with. These were questions that were laid out in the federal rules when they were published in the preamble language, but they're also in your favorite resource, the Federal Student Aid Handbook. These are questions that you are going to want to memorize, take with you, maybe put on a little cheat chart to help you remember what you have to do when you have a student who's in a program offered in modules. What we're going to do now is we're going to walk through these questions and then look at a series of examples, some fun examples, we might add. And what we'll do at that point is once we've gone through these questions, we'll then take a quick minute to answer any questions you may have about concepts up to that point. So let's look at the first question. So the first question reads, after beginning attendance in the period, did the student cease to attend or fail to begin attendance in a course he or she was scheduled to attend? You know, if no, when you're asking this question, then you don't have a withdrawal, okay? But if you answer yes, you need to go to the second question. So again, these are sequential questions that you don't want to ask out of order. So now looking at the second question, when the student ceased to attend or failed to begin attendance in a course that he or she was scheduled to attend, was the student still attending any other courses? So if you answer yes to this question, you do not have a withdrawal, but you have to remember that there may be certain regulatory provisions that are going to apply here. An example of that is where you have a case where a student maybe has Pell Grant funds and the Pell amount has to be adjusted in addition to the Pell cost of attendance. Now if the answer is no, and you may be hoping that it's no, right, you're going to move to the third and final question. This third and final question simply boils back to, did the student confirm attendance in a course or in a module beginning later in the period. Okay, so did they confirm attendance? Now, obviously, if you have a non-term or non-standard term program, you know, we still have to remember that that course has to start no later than 45 calendar days after the end of the module that that student ceased attending. Okay, that's an important part here. So, you know, if you answer yes, they did confirm, it's not a withdrawal. But remember, though, we talked earlier that you have to go back and check. You have to have some sort of mechanism in place to make sure that they do return. Because if they don't return, then you have a withdrawal. And that's going to be essentially the situation that we have here. Okay, so now this was the third question. So now what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at some scenarios here that we need to drill down and actually ask these questions. Now, is this tedious? Absolutely, it is tedious. But you have to drill down these questions. Not only are you required to, but more importantly, you want to get the questions right. So that's why you have to drill down. So for those of you that don't like logic and flowcharts, this is going to be tough. Okay. So let's say we have a situation here. We have a term. It's comprised of three modules. And each module is actually 5 weeks in length with no breaks in between. I did this to keep you with me here, okay? So this is, maybe not a simplistic example, but it's a little bit easier than when you might have breaks. And we'll talk about what that means. So we have a student. They're scheduled to complete 2 courses in each of the first 2 modules. So what this means is they have 2 courses for module A, and they have 2 courses for module B. So say this student begins attendance in both courses for module A, but ceases to attend all courses a few days later, and they do not provide confirmation that he or she returned later in the period. So the question becomes, does return of Title IV funds apply? Yes. Yeah. If you have the handout, it does say yes. Okay. But it does apply. Okay. And what we need to do now is we need to drill back and we need to walk through those questions. So let's review the sequence that we just kept in mind. First, after beginning attendance in 2 courses during Module A, that student ceased to attend these 2 courses and failed to begin attendance in the other courses that they were scheduled to attend for Module B. Okay. Second, the student ceased to attend the scheduled 2 courses in Module A. That student was not attending any other courses. So now when we drill down to the third question, you know, obviously that student did not provide confirmation of attendance, okay? And so to come back for either modules B or C, so that's why they're considered withdrawn, okay? Remember though, okay, in this example too, the tricky thing, while this is, a scenario-based situation, we could alter this. You know, if the student didn't provide the confirmation, obviously you would treat it as a withdrawal, complete the calculation within the appropriate time frames. But if the student came back unbeknownst to you and finished the period, then you would have to undo the calculation in that case. So that's a little bit of a derivative of the situation that we have at hand. Okay, can't get enough, right? You probably think, I've had enough. Okay, let's look at another example. So in this example, say we have a student and they're scheduled to complete 2 courses in the first 2 modules. Again, 2 courses for module A and 2 courses for module B. So what if that student began attendance in both courses in module A, but they actually just dropped 1 course in module A after a few days? They got tired of it, dropped it up. Would return to Title IV funds apply? No, absolutely not. It would not. And not just because your handout says no. So what we need to do is we need to step back for a minute, because remember that even though it does not apply, there may be other regulatory provisions that you have to consider and recalculate some of their aid now that they've stopped out a course. So let's take a look again at the sequence of questions we need to keep in mind. After beginning attendance in the period, the student did cease to attend a course that they were scheduled to attend in Module A. That's very clear. But though they ceased to attend 1 course, they still continue to attend another. So that's the difference here, and this is why it would not be considered a withdrawal. Okay, we've got another one for you. lots of fun again. So in this example, let's take a look here. We have a student who's scheduled to complete two courses in the first two modules, two courses for A, two courses for B. Now, if the student completes two courses in module A, but officially drops two courses in module B while still attending those courses in A, does return of Title IV funds apply? It does not apply, okay? Now, we need to walk through our questions again. Keep in mind, though, even though it doesn't apply, there may be a recalculation that may be necessary. So because this student officially dropped both courses in B prior, before the module began, that student did not cease to attend or fail to begin attendance in a course that they were scheduled to attend. That's the spirit of that example. So timing in this instance is critical. Now, we're going to also talk about some other timing factors that you'll need to consider, because we could see a scenario where maybe that changes. Okay. So now that we've talked about those particular examples, are there any specific questions before we move on to percentage of the period completed? Go right ahead.
I had a question about the confirmation of intent to return.
Okay. Having seen their webinar very briefly, what I can tell you about future enrollment, you know, what we're talking about here, and this is a carve out actually in the Federal Student Aid Handbook, is that future enrollment at the time of withdrawal would be considered confirmation. And again, this is a limited exception that the department provides. So in the example that I provided earlier, what happens in that situation is, at the time that the student is withdrawing, they add another course at that time. So what you are getting from that added course is you're getting their intent to return to a future module. And that's, again, that's the spirit of what they are seeking when they're seeking this confirmation. Does that help?
A little. So the fact that they're enrolled already in the future is not confirmation.
That is correct. The fact that they are enrolled for a course does not mean, well, you know, enrolled in a previously enrolled course, that's the language I'll use. If they are enrolled in a previous course, that doesn't mean a confirmation. Again, at the time of withdrawal, they're taking an action to enroll in a course. And again, that is a carve out of guidance that's actually in the Federal Student Aid Handbook. And an excellent question. Other questions? Going once, going twice. Yes?
So if there's only, say, one semester out of an entire, say, four-year program, there's only one semester in which this particular program students will be in modules. That period we have to treat as a modular period for return of funds purposes, even though the program, the entire degree program, bachelor's degree, four-year bachelor's degree, for example, is not a modular program.
That's correct. Your understanding is correct. Okay. So this is one, within the program, one term. Students take some coursework that span the entire period, and they may take some that do not.
Exactly.
Again, you're making a determination on a period-by-period basis that, in that instance, for that period, it would be modular.
I have one question.
Yes.
On the recalculation, you have on your flow chart, you only have to do that for Pell and campus-based funds. So we have grad students that are consistently in module programs.
Sure.
And for one reason or another, they, you know, usually work-related, can't attend the second modular. So do I have to recalculate and send all their aid back?
Well, it's to your point about revisions and where they would apply, obviously Pell is one, and campus-based programs, if you participate, them would also be another one. But recalculating, you would be making adjustments to their aid. Now, it may be some of their aid, it may be all of their aid. I mean, it's really going to depend upon that particular situation that you're looking at?
Well, they go to like 8 hours to 4 hours.
So they drop from half
time.
Now, this is a graduate time. Student that's only getting campus-based aid?
No, it's just Stafford funds.
Stafford funds. Now, have all disbursements on that funds, have those funds been made?
Yes.
So in that instance, once all the disbursement of those Stafford loan funds for this particular graduate student have been made, there's no overaward.
Okay.
And that's consistent with your overaward guidance in the handbook.
Okay.
So what could become tricky in your situation is a case where disbursements are made. There's not single disbursements. There's multiple disbursements that are being made. That could raise some questions and whether or not the disbursements have been made.
Okay,
good point. Okay, I'll tell you what, let's keep moving along, right? Talk about calculating the percentage of the period completed. So what we need to do now is we need to look at this particular case. You know, remember in general, and this was covered under basics, but we want to reemphasize, you know, when you're talking about the percentage of payment period completed for a credit hour program, we're talking about the total number of calendar days that they complete in this, obviously in this period, and that's divided into the total number of calendar days in the period. Obviously, you're going to exclude breaks that are 5 or consecutive days that are greater from the numerator and the denominator. But where this gets tricky is if there's breaks between the modules, okay? And if those breaks are 5 or consecutive days or greater, you need to exclude them out. However, if they're less than 5, you will need to include them in the period. And we're going to walk through an example here, okay, that's going to help us illustrate these points. So we're going to do a little bit of math for those of you that like math. And for those of you that don't like math, we'll bring you along with us, okay? Okay. Let's say we have a case where this is a school that has a term. The term is comprised of 4 4-week modules, right? We had to make it more than 3. So in this case, between each module, there's a break of 4 days, okay? So what we have to ask, and this is the basic question, is how many days are actually in this period, okay? So the answer, if you have it on the handout, is 124, okay? But what's important here is to walk through the methodology of how we got there, okay? So let's do the math. So we have a case where, you know, each module is 4 weeks. And now we know that there are 7 days in a week, right? So we're going to multiply 4 weeks times 7, and that's going to get us the total number of days. That's going to give us 28 days, okay? And if we multiply 28 days times 4 modules, we're going to have 112 days, okay? For those of you that just did the math on your calculator, great job, okay? However, The one variable that we need to account here is we need to account for the breaks between the modules, okay? So I said there were 3 breaks, right? Well, 4 modules, you know that there's a break in between, so we get 3 breaks. Each break has 4 days, so 3 breaks times 4 days gives us 12. So now we're going to add 112 plus 12, and that's going to give us 124 days. That's pretty complex, okay? In my situation, my breaks were equal, okay? There may be some cases where the breaks may vary a little bit. Maybe one is 5, one is, you know, less than that. It's going to depend. It's going to depend upon your program. But the best recommendation here is to make sure you have a calendar in front of you, a physical calendar to help you walk through all the days in the period, and then you can start to exclude those that you need to, as opposed to keeping those that you need to keep. Okay, now let's look at another scenario. Let's say we have a student who ceases attendance in the first of 3 modules that he or she is scheduled to attend, and then they drop two classes in the remaining 2 modules prior to beginning attendance in the second module. In this question here, the question is, does the total number of calendar days, is that the total number of calendar days in the period, Or is that going to include all the days or just those days from the first module? Okay. Well, in this case, okay, this is going to include the total days in the period themselves. So what that means is that it's going to include all the days for all three modules. What's important here to understand is that you have to remember that in our example, the student actually ceased attendance first, and then they made adjustments later to their enrollment status to Module 2 and Module 3. So timing here in this one's important, because what you might ask, well, why is that important? Well, it's because the department has actually issued guidance. You know, they've said, look, adjustments that happen after the student has ceased attendance, after they've withdrawn, don't matter at that point. So in this instance, because that student has stopped and then dropped later, you would look at all the days in that period and count them as part of that denominator. Okay, so that's going to be an important guidance that you need. However, let's contrast that scenario with timing again and look back at that. What if they had dropped the courses and then withdrawn? Well, in that instance, we'd only be looking at the first module and basically those days in that module as the denominator. Okay, so as you can appreciate, just from these situations alone that we've examined, this is some tough stuff. So this is why you will want, and it's highly recommended, an internal control to help you walk through each student's situation, you know, given that it can vary. Okay. You may have thought, well, wait a minute. You know, that was a special situation all its own, right? Now we're going to talk about some other special situations. Did I saw a question? No? No question? Okay. Sure.
In essence,
if the student, in a summer term, we have, say, a summer one and a summer two.
Okay.
And a summer three.
So you have three modules, summer one, summer two, summer three, mm-hmm. that comprise a term. Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm with you.
Okay. So, and they enroll in summer one, two classes.
Okay.
And summer two, two classes.
Okay.
If they cease to attend summer one, then both terms are considered in the R2T4 calculation as total number of days because they were enrolled prior to starting classes.
So they remember, I'd start with this. We have a term that's comprised of three modules. The student is enrolled in module one and module two. They have courses in module one and courses in module two. What we have to do is when they cease these courses, we have to go back to our questions again. And we have to ask those questions again. One, that student did cease. They did cease to attend courses. Okay. However, were they scheduled to attend more courses? In that instance, for the module two, they are scheduled to attend more courses. So in that instance, they're not really considered withdrawn at that point. Okay. Now, those provisions, the regulatory provisions, if they receive Pell, that would apply because we would then be changing their, we'd have to account for their change in an enrollment status in that instance. Okay. Does that help?
No, because what you answered the young lady back there was that you can't use that future enrollments as intent to stay enrolled.
Well, try to articulate that a little bit more clearly. You would have to get written confirmation for them because in this example, the student has not added any more courses at the time of withdrawal. If they were to add more courses for, let's say, the third module or even for the second on top of what they already have enrollment for, mm-hmm. that would be considered confirmation. Does that clarify?
Yes. And so then the question was when we're doing the art, say we... So we wouldn't do an R2T4 calculation until after the second module starts and see whether or not they attend. And then in that case, the total number of days for both terms would be considered part of the calculation.
Well, if they do not return, yes, return of Title IV funds would apply. Mm-hmm. And in that instance, if you were looking at what applied here, we'd be talking about the total days for the denominator would be for Module 1 and Module 2. And then module for the numerator, it would be just simply what they've completed from first and second.
Mm-hmm. All right, thank you.
Sure, great question. Some very tough stuff, right? Okay, Now let's look at a couple of special situations. We're going to talk about inadvertent overpayment. We'll talk about a case where a PLUS loan's been denied. We'll look at the death of a student. And, well, we won't look at a death of a student, but we'll talk about that situation. And then we'll talk about verification and also some audit and program review findings. Okay. So what we need to look at here is inadvertent overpayments. You may or may not be familiar with these, but we need to ask, well, what is an inadvertent overpayment? You know, it really sounds like what it is. It's a case where you make a disbursement unknowingly to a student who's no longer in attendance at school, okay? Now, the department, the guidance that they've prescribed is to simply count these inadvertent overpayments as aid that could have been dispersed, okay, in your calculation. So you may be thinking, okay, remember, too, that when you look at these overpayments, they also need to meet the conditions of a late disbursement prior to the withdrawal, okay? So you have to keep those conditions in mind when you're looking at these situations, because if they don't meet the conditions, you wouldn't count it as aid that could have been dispersed. So what they've said in the past is they're going to look at patterns or, you know, practice of inadvertent overpayment. I mean, they're looking at a lot of other things, too. So, but keep in mind, that's consistent with what they've said. So here's an example, and this one will help you. Let's say we have a case where, a student is in a term, and, you know, they receive a first disbursement of aid. Obviously, the school checks eligibility, so we have a good student. They make the first disbursement. We have a case where now another disbursement coming around the corner. We're checking eligibility. Things look great. And then all of a sudden, at the end of the period comes around and the student receives all Fs, okay? Now, as a school, obviously, we because they've unofficially withdrawn, we can't presume that they earned those Fs unless we have a policy in place that says they did, okay? And if there's no policy, you have to work your way back and determine whether or not they truly earned them or if they unofficially withdrew. Now, if they unofficially withdrew, we might decide, okay, let's go ahead and use the midpoint as a withdrawal date. So your midpoint is prior to your second disbursement. In that instance, you have an inadvertent overpayment because you obviously wouldn't have made a disbursement to the student had you known that they were not there, okay? This midpoint, it might also be the last date of an academically related activity. But again, the point being is that it's they withdrew prior to the withdrawal date in this instance is prior to the disbursement being made. At a school that keeps attendance records, you're not going to see this happen. You should not see it happen, only because you've got records of when the student actually left. Okay, now let's look at a PLUS loan denial. Let's say we've completed a return of Title IV funds calculation, including a PLUS loan, whether this be a parent PLUS loan or a graduate PLUS loan, and the loan is later denied by the department for some various reason. Now, in this case, you've done a calculation already, so now you have to revise it, right? Now, what you're going to do is keep in mind that if there's changes that need to be made, obviously you're going to need to make appropriate systems updates, okay, whether that be through COD, and may even include, returning or getting back money from where you've sent it back, maybe through G5. Now, the other thing to keep in mind, too, is that if this was the only Title IV aid on that return of Title IV funds calculation, you're in great shape because you don't need to do the calculation. Just pull it back and you're done. Okay. Now let's look at the death of a student within a period. So, we see this question from time to time, at least once a term. What happens if a student dies within a period? While there's certainly no doubt that you're going to handle this with the utmost care and in accordance with your policies, there's certainly some things you have to keep in mind with respect to return of Title IV funds. Certainly first, a school is required to perform a calculation. That's a common question we receive, whether you have to do anything. Now, when you perform this calculation, if there is unearned aid by the school would continue to be responsible for returning those funds within the date of determination, within 45 days. Now, where it gets tricky, though, is if there's a grant overpayment. Now, if there's a grant overpayment that's actually due from the student, you're not going to report an overpayment. You're instructed not to, and you're instructed not to try to collect either from the student's estate, because the student's estate is never billed for an overpayment in this situation. Now, remember, too, that you know, if the student has student loans, obviously those would be discharged, and you can certainly provide the loan holder with documentation to start that process. And then sometimes, too, the loan holder may be aware in some instances. So, but remember, too, that if you're thinking about this return of Title IV funds calculation, you know, you may have a case where the calculation shows that a post-withdrawal disbursement is due. Don't do it, okay? Because you cannot make a post-withdrawal disbursement to the student's estate in that instance. Now, there's also been some questions that we've received about the withdrawal date and what the withdrawal date may be. So we're going to take a look at that. So for a school not required to take attendance, this is pretty straightforward. Remember that, you know, it's based on the date of the student's death, okay? For a school required to take attendance, in this instance, for a school required to take attendance, it's different. It's the last date of attendance based on the school's records. Now, for both either attendance taking or non-attendance taking, just make sure to keep appropriate documentation on file when you run into these situations. Okay. Now we're going to talk about verification. Now I will say this, and my hope is this, that you know this particular situation can be very tricky because it involves verification deadlines in addition to return to Title IV funds deadlines. Okay, so my hope is that these situations are simply a handful for you. But if they're not, I'm going to recommend that you take a look at the AVG, because there's some timing factors that we need to account for as we're thinking about these situations. Now, you could have a case, you know, you might ask, well, what happens when verification's completed, but before the return of Title IV deadline requirements? Okay, so in this instance, if you have a student who provides all documentation required for verification after withdrawing, but before the verification submission deadline, because remember, the submission deadline is outlined in your policy, and in time for the school to meet the 30-day deadline associated with offering a post-withdrawal disbursement, the school has to perform the return of Title IV funds calculation. Now, in the calculation, the school would actually include all Title IV aid for which the student has established eligibility based on verification, because that's been completed. And obviously, the conditions for late disbursement that have been met prior to the student's withdrawal. So again, this is a timing factor. The verification has been completed, and this is before the 30-day post-withdrawal disbursement deadline. Okay, well now, what happens if verification's not completed but before the return deadline? This is a little bit different. Now, if you have a student who has withdrawn and does not provide those required documents in time for the school to complete the verification process and to meet the 45-day return deadline, so it's a little bit of a different standard here, the school must calculate return on Title IV using Title IV aid that was not subject to verification. This is going to be your PLUS loan funds and your unsubsidized loan funds. You would include these loan funds if they meet the conditions for a late disbursement prior to the student's withdrawal. Okay. Now, let's take a look at what happens when verification is completed, but it's after the return deadline. So if before the verification deadline, but after the school has completed the calculation, because we have done that already, the student provides all the documentation required for verification, the school has to perform a new calculation. So it must include as aid that could have been dispersed all the federal aid for which that student has actually established eligibility based on verification. And again, the conditions for conditions of late disbursement have been met as well, okay? Again, my hope is that these are unique situations that do not happen every day at your campus, but they are very specialized. And with verification deadlines, considering those, the application and verification guide is going to be your best resource. Okay. Now we're going to talk about, we're going to bring this to a close, and we're going to talk about audit and program review problems and findings. So a common issue and common finding that we see, and obviously the department, we're all well aware of this, is that, funds are being returned late. You know, so what we mean is that from the date of determination, funds are not returned by the 45-day return deadline. Or, or if you return funds by paper check, as an example, that doesn't meet the bank doesn't endorse it within 60 days as of the check being cut from the date of determination. So, you have to sit back and ask, well, why are funds being returned late? I can give you just a few examples. Probably one is going to be the tracking. Schools are not using a report to track how much time they have left to return funds. It could also be that maybe there's some, a rough patch of communication between department and campus. Sometimes communication can be tough, but remember, this is a school administrative requirement. When we say school, we mean the collaborative effort of your brothers and sisters at the bursar's office and registrar's office and the academic departments. And no, they are not the stepchildren of this as well, okay? Fair enough, good point. So there's some strategies that we've placed on this slide to maybe help you think about how can we fix this, And an obvious one is better communication. This is a very important administrative task, and you don't want to have to fix these problems after a program review has pointed them out to you. That is not fun by any situation. For those of you that use the web tracking tool or the return of Title IV funds on the web, there is a reporting feature that can help you track those days, okay, and what's left over, so that way it can help you prioritize those that need to be returned as opposed to those where you maybe still have some more flexibility. And then also maybe just looking in general at your policies and procedures and your processes, more importantly, about how you can improve those. Where could they be more efficient? And again, if this involves multiple departments on your campus, they definitely need to be integrated into this. Another finding issue, return of Title IV funds calculation errors. We were talking this morning about how there are so many elements within a calculation that if an element is wrong, your calculation could possibly be completely wrong. As an example, if the percentage of aid earned is calculated incorrectly, well, I hate to say it, but the calc's wrong. Amounts that are put in incorrectly could lead to an incorrect amount. The withdrawal date, if you don't have the right withdrawal date, that could also lead to an incorrect calculation. Institutional charges, if the incorrect institutional charges are used, that could also lead to an incorrect calculation. So some points to consider here, obviously use the correct charges, right? But I know that sounds easy, but there's a little bit of a trick here, because there are some schools that, when they bill institutional charges, they bill for an entire period, okay? However, if the calculation is based on a payment period as opposed to a period of enrollment, you have to step back and you're going to need to prorate charges, okay? That could make a significant difference. And then also understanding when a charge is considered institutional. We see that in instances where a program thinks that the books and supplies, as an example, are not institutional charges, but yet they really may be, especially if there's not a real reasonable opportunity for those students to get those books and supplies elsewhere. And that's going to vary by program by program. So things that can help you. In this instance, we encourage you to leverage the web-based tool, leverage the department's, even their department's paper application, and here's why. There may be some internal systems that you have, or if you have a homegrown form that you've built since 1998, when this was first, conceived, if you will, by the Congress and the department, things have changed, and it would be helpful for you to use their forms only because that provides you some coverage as opposed to your homegrown form that may or may not have been checked in that instance. So with that being said, We have a little bit of time for questions. There's obviously some suggested resources that can help you here. You know, the latest Dear Colleague letter, Gen 1114, has a lot of questions and can provide you helpful guidance on modules and attendance-taking requirements that are now new. In addition, everyone should have a handout that provides you information about programs offered in modules. So if you're trying to explain this to upper administration or to those folks that don't understand what you do, you can give them a one-page summary and say, look, these are the new requirements related to modules. This is why we need some help, or why we need some additional reporting help, if you will, to identify these students as an example. And then there's also a helpful illustration that is based upon the three questions that we covered. And these three questions are obviously very important for you to be aware of and to leverage when you're looking at someone who's in a program that's offered in modules. So we hope that this diagram will help you and will help you illustrate how to walk through and determine whether or not someone has withdrawn. So at this point, we have a couple minutes. We have about 5 minutes, so we can look at some questions or talk through some situations. We do have mics standing by.
I had a question about the numerator calculation. If we're dealing, the way I'm seeing it is kind of like a double withdrawal. The student is withdrawing from a first module, and they do confirm their attendance for the second module.
Okay.
But then they later have to withdraw from the second module as well. Are we automatically going to be counting all of the days in the first module in the numerator, or do we need to go back and individually count only those days that they were enrolled and then add only the days they were enrolled in the second module?
Bingo. You're going to be looking at the second answer, because remember, in our example, we have a student who the term is two modules.
Mm-hmm.
Student completes some course. They're registered for both. They complete some days in module A and stop out, mm-hmm. right? And the sheer essence of them completing some days in module A or module 1, they've earned some money for those days. Now, again, they may stop out and come back for module 2. You know, again, they've given confirmation, written confirmation, and they come back, but they, again, stop out. The denominator is easy in that instance, but the numerator, tabulating that, would just simply be based on the days that they've completed. Now, the day that they withdraw also counts as a day completed. So an excellent question.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure. Yes, ma'am.
Unofficial withdrawal on the students that had lines, when you did those returns, did you include lines or just the pale?
Your question is unofficial withdrawals. Mm-hmm. They've received grants and loans. And you determine they stopped out, and then you're using the midpoint as the
yes.
as the period. So if the school did not earn a percentage of the loan funds and grant funds, obviously the school may have an obligation to return those funds, because in the instance of using the midpoint, they've not, you know, we're talking about 50% of the aid earned, and that's going to mean that the school has earned 50% of the, you know, funds that were applied to, that were awarded, or 50% times the institutional charges that they originally billed. Okay.
So we should include loans.
From a school perspective, absolutely. The calculation will, as you walk through the calculation, it will demonstrate whether or not funds have to be returned by the school. Now, if it's unearned loan funds by the student in the calculation, which goes back to maybe steps 7 and 10, those funds that were unearned by the student, are loan funds in particular, are returned in accordance with a promissory note. So in that instance, a student who has a loan obligation under the calculation, those funds would not be returned by the student at that point. Excellent question. Thank you. Oh, sure. And just to clarify, so the situation here is loan funds. Obviously, from a calculation, if there's unearned aid by the school and by the student, loan funds that are unearned by the school are returned. Loan funds that are unearned by the student, they're returned in accordance with the promissory note provisions. Does that help? So essentially, they're not paying those funds back right there at the point of withdrawal. They're repaying them back when they enter repayment. That's right. That's right.
Loan funds, grant funds, everything's included.
Everything is included.
And what spits out at the end tells you this much the school has to return, this much the student may have to return. And if that's a loan.
Under the student's portion.
Under the student's portion, then that's just done
with the repayment. That's done in repayment. That is correct. We've got 1 minute. Two questions, 1 minute. We will be here for, at the Cyber Cafe discussion for this afternoon. So if you think of any questions, feel free to send them our way.
Just a reminder,